You're likely familiar with the phrase financial institutions, but what are those institutions? One way to think about it is that some of these companies are banks, while other companies that are considered financial institutions are non-banks. Banks are institutions that accept deposits and make loans. These include commercial banks, savings and loan associations, mutual savings banks, and credit unions. Companies that are considered financial institutions but not banks include insurance companies, finance companies, pension funds, mutual fund, and investment banks. As mentioned earlier, the Federal Reserve acts as the bank for banks and the federal government. The Fed holds deposits for commercial banks and offers loans to those banks in times of financial stress. But that's not all we do. The Federal Reserve promotes financial stability in a number of ways, during day-to-day activities, as well as in times of crisis. In normal times, the Fed has four important roles to maintain a stable environment: conducting monetary policy, supervising and regulating banks, providing payment services for the U.S. Treasury, and serving as the lender of last resort for banks and other financial institutions. However, sometimes circumstances arise to threaten the stable environment. Let's take a look at a time when the Fed had to react to an unforeseen situation.
You're in the Situation Room happening now. We're following breaking news.
Less than 2 years after Chairman Bernanke took office, he was faced with the worst financial crisis since the Great Depression.
In a panic, when people are pulling all their money out of financial institutions, what the central bank does is provide short-term loans, which help the banks stabilize. And that's what we did during 2008-2009. If you ask most people, I think they would say that the Fed spent a lot of taxpayer money trying to stop the crisis and bailed out banks and that kind of thing. The fact is, the Fed doesn't spend government money. What the Fed does is buy and sell assets in the market.
Those assets are U.S. Treasury bonds and government-guaranteed mortgage securities.
Or we make short-term loans, which are then repaid.
Loans repaid with interest.
In the last 3 years, the Fed has given the Treasury $200 billion. That's profit. That's not loss. That's not cost.
In order to provide a broad perspective on the economy in all parts of the nation, the Federal Reserve required a unique structure. As mentioned earlier, the Fed consists of 12 regional reserve banks that provide feedback on business, economic, and banking conditions in each district. The president of each bank is nominated by the bank's board of directors and confirmed by the Federal Reserve Board of Governors. The Board of Governors consists of a 7-member group that provides a national view of economic conditions. The governors are nominated by the President of the United States and confirmed by the Senate for a 14-year term. Together, the Fed governors and Reserve Bank presidents make up the Federal Open Market Committee, or FOMC. This group serves as the decision-making body for U.S. monetary policy. In order to achieve its dual mandate to promote maximum sustainable employment and stable prices, the FOMC can ease, tighten, or maintain current monetary policies. The FOMC gathers at 8 regularly scheduled meetings each year to discuss the nation's economy. All 7 governors and the president of the New York Fed vote at each meeting. Of the remaining 11 bank presidents, 4 rotate each year to fill out the remaining voting seats. This next exhibit might appear familiar as it looks similar to a game most of you have played at some point. The woodblock tower teaches visitors about banking laws and regulations. Just like the blocks that hold up this tower, these laws often build on one another and interconnect, creating a complex and multifaceted banking system. The best part of this fun exhibit is the hidden drawers that open up to reveal more facts and information about these laws. The museum's scrolling timeline allows you to examine an extensive list of dates and events that have taken place both here at the St. Louis Fed as well as in the Federal Reserve System over the last 100 years. For example, the St. Louis Fed building opened in 1925, and here you can view a picture of what it looked like at that time. You can see wires running across the roads and attached to the building. Those were for the streetcar lines on Broadway. The hooks that held them are still in the side of the building today. Other events, such as the selection of each St. Louis Bank president and Federal Reserve chair, are highlighted. If you want to learn more history, be sure to visit Fraser, the bank's digital library of U.S. economic, financial, and banking history, particularly the history of the Fed system. This image of the Earth's city lights was created from NASA's system, designed to track clouds by moonlight, as well as permanent lights on the Earth's surface. The brightest areas of the Earth are those most urbanized, not necessarily the most populated. The museum is located here in St. Louis, but you can easily identify several other nearby and large cities on the map. Kansas City, Chicago, Washington, D.C., and New York are easy to identify. There are also some interesting things that can be seen around the world. In Egypt, the path of the Nile River is very prominent, as 95% of that nation's residents live along the river. Long stretches of lights across Russia show cities and towns along the Trans-Siberian Railway. Finally, looking at the Korean Peninsula, there is a significant difference between North Korea and South Korea. While South Korea emits bright light from its many large cities, some parts of North Korea are so dark, it is hard to distinguish land from the neighboring ocean. As you saw in the Earth at Night photo, the amount of light emanating from cities around the world can be quite different from one another. Other differences can be seen in how people travel, the food people eat, and what school classrooms look like. Take a look at these classrooms from around the world and compare them with a classroom you have been in. Is there one that looks similar to your classroom? Next is the museum's most popular exhibit, the gold bar. This very secure exhibit holds a real gold bar. If you have an opportunity to visit the museum in person, you can even try to lift it, but it's not easy. The bar doesn't seem very big, measuring just 10 inches long, but it weighs in at nearly 28 pounds because gold is a very dense material. Besides providing the opportunity to lift a gold bar, this exhibit also explains the gold standard and why the U.S. no longer uses it. A gold standard is a monetary system in which the value of money is equal to a specified amount of gold. To maintain a gold standard, governments must be ready and willing to buy and sell gold at a set price. When the Fed was formed in 1913, a major part of its job was to maintain the value of the dollar in terms of gold. At that time, the Fed had to have 40 cents worth of gold for every dollar it issued. During the Great Depression, the demand for goods and services fell and dragged down the U.S. price level, requiring the Fed to hold gold to create money, severely restricted its ability to stimulate the economy and maintain stable prices. The U.S. abandoned the gold standard in the 1930s and has used a fiat currency system ever since. A fiat system means that money is not backed by gold, but by the full faith and credit of the government. The gold bar exhibit also identifies where gold is stored in the U.S. As you can see from this pie chart, over half of the gold in the U.S. is held at Fort Knox in Kentucky. A majority of the rest is held at the other U.S. mint facilities, while the New York Federal Reserve Bank holds the remaining 5%. Here you can also see just how large the supply of gold really is. It weighs more than some of the most well-known monuments in the country, including the Statue of Liberty and the Liberty Bell. The last two exhibits look at two free public resources hosted here at the bank. FRED, or Federal Reserve Economic Data, is the home of hundreds of thousands of data figures, including everyday facts like interest rates, employment, housing statistics, and even the price of a gallon of gas. You can visit FRED online or download the FRED app on your phone to analyze economic data that interests you. Some of this data can also be seen in GeoFRED. This unique site allows you to create maps of data found in FRED. Let's look at an example focusing on the percent of population with a high school diploma here in the 8th District. That brings you to the end of the tour. We hope that you enjoyed it and come away with a better understanding of the economy. At the very least, we hope we've piqued your interest to come lift our genuine gold bar in person. Thanks for visiting, and we hope to someday host you right here in St. Louis.